H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Okay, so we'll get started. As usual, like if you have any questions, you can ask me in the chat window. So my voice will not be clear like how it's before. I have a little cold today. So okay, so we'll get started. So tomorrow on the next class, whenever we have next class, I'm going to ask questions to all of you on the topics what we have discussed so far. So I'll be asking questions on data types, operators, and we'll be seeing exception handling. So all the concepts, whatever we have discussed so far, I'm going to ask questions, and we'll also have exam like how we had before on the topics which we discussed. Okay. Now let's get started for today's class. So let me open the course content, and okay. So today we are going to discuss on object-oriented programming concepts. So anything which is there pending in this section, we'll come back to this section again, and we are going to start object-oriented programming concepts. So very important concept. So this will be the target for in interviews. So anyone who says like they are good in C#, definitely for sure questions are in object-oriented programming concepts. So we are going to learn today what is a class, what is an object, and what are the access modifiers. So we'll see how it goes. Okay, so let me open Visual Studio. Visual Studio I'm using 2013. Very important concepts, object-oriented programming concepts in C#. So it's taking time. Okay, so now okay, file. Okay, it's still taking time. Okay, file, new project. So I'm going to create a new console application. So for those who just joined, like I'm going to create a new console application. File, new project in Visual Studio. I'm going to select file, new project, and I'm going to select a console application. And now if you see the name of the console application is console application 52. So let me click on OK. Okay, so it's creating project for me. I don't know, today Visual Studio also a bit slow. Okay. So now, as we already discussed, like a class is you can tell like a collection of methods and variables. This is one definition of class. So I repeat again, a class is a collection of methods and variables. So we'll see other definitions of class as well. So a class is like a blueprint to create objects. So we'll see that. We'll try to understand the definitions for a class. For now, you can assume that a class is a collection of methods and variables. I repeat again, a class is a collection of methods and variables. And a namespace which you have here, is a collection of classes. A namespace is a collection of classes, or it can be the collection of namespaces as well. So here, this is a class program. By default, it's getting created. So now let's try to create another class. For example, I want to create my own class here. So I'm going to create a class Math Library. Okay, I am just creating a new class which is Math Library. The name of the class is Math Library, and I'm going to have a method inside that for adding two numbers. So public. So I'll tell what is public. I'm going to write int, and here I'm writing add numbers. So for adding two numbers, I need the parameter. I need two values. So int a comma int b. So now if I add this, so here I'm going to return a plus b. So all I did was I'm adding a new class. For the first time you are seeing code like this, I'm going to add a new class inside this namespace console application. So now you are seeing two classes. One class is program and the other class is math library. And in console application, the execution of program starts at main method. Okay, the execution of the C# program starts at main method, and inside main method we don't have anything as of now. So now if I want to add numbers, till now how we are doing to add two numbers, forget about this class math library. So let me comment it out. Okay, so I have just commented. Till now in the course, if you want to add two numbers, we used to like this. So int a comma b, and we used to write a is equal to here we'll write console.writeLine, and we'll write here enter first number. Okay, and then here we'll write a is equal to what do we need to write? console.readLine, and before that we will write here convert.toInt. So because console.readLine is string and convert.toInt 32, so we are converting that string to integer. Okay, now I'm going to read for the second number, enter second number. So I'm going to copy this again and I'm going to paste it here, and here enter second number, and I'm going to read that value to variable b. So now if I want to add these two numbers, I used to write here another variable, or let me take like this comma c, and we'll write here c is equal to a plus b, and we'll write here console.writeLine, we'll write sum of, and here we'll write floor brackets 0 and floor brackets 1 equal to floor brackets 2, and after this we are going to write a comma b comma c. Okay, so this is how we used to do. How many of you are not clear in this? So we know this, right? How to read a number, and this is a read line, and we are converting to integer, and we are storing in variable a, and we are storing it in variable b. And how many of you don't know this? Giving like this floor brackets, other than for those who joined today, anyone else don't know this? Floor bracket 0, 1 and 2. So this value, whatever you see here, will be printed. A value will be printed in floor bracket 0, and B value will be printed in floor brackets 1, and C value, which is here, will be printed in instead of this place. So now let me run this program. Okay, so enter first number, I'm going to enter the first number as 5. Enter second number, I'm going to enter this 10. So what do I need to do? I'm not able to see the output. So what is that I need to do? The output is coming and it's getting disappeared. So what is that I need to do? I need to add console.readLine. Perfect. So console.readLine. Okay. Now let me execute this. So now let me give the first number, enter first number 5, and enter second number 10. So now I can see that sum of 5 and 10 is 15. So here, this is what I'm talking about. In this 0 place, in this floor bracket 0 place, whatever you put here after the comma first one, that is going to be printed here. So I have entered here 5, and you can see that sum of here it is coming 5. So which is actually a. Sum of 5 and 10 is equal to 15. So sum of 5 and 10 is equal to 15. So this is about the simple program which I used to do before. Now let's try to do using a new class. So let's try to create a new class. So I'm going to create a new class called Math Library. So if you see here, we are going to create a new class Math Library inside this namespace. So all of you know already that a namespace is collection of one or more classes, or a namespace can also have another namespace inside that. So now what I'm doing, I'm going to create a class called Math Library. Okay, now what I'm going to do, I have to access this method math add numbers, I have to create an object of this math library. So let's see how to create an object of math library. So what I'll do now, I'll create an object here. So I'll create an object for math library. So we need to create like this: math library ML is equal to new math library, and here I just created an object. So now this ML is an object for math library. Okay, so if I want to access methods, if I want to access public methods of a class, I need to give ml.addNumbers. So what I need to write here is, instead of giving a plus b, I'll call this method, this addNumbers method. So how to call that? I need to give ml.addNumbers, and I need to pass here a comma b. So the purpose of this creating separate classes, wherever you want, you can actually reuse these methods. So assume that if you're writing logic here, for example, let's try to add a function for calculating factorial of a number. So for that, you already know how to calculate factorial. So let's try to write that method: public int factorial and int n. And here, anyone wants to help me in this, writing this code factorial? Who wants to help me? You can unmute and tell me the logic. So anyone wants to help me with the factorial logic? Or tell me, have you done factorial program before?
Yes.
Yeah. So who wants to help me?
We have to declare a variable fact equal to 1.
Perfect. In fact equal to 1. Okay.
Comma I.
Okay.
And we are taking loop, for loop.
Yeah, perfect. So we need to write a for loop for I is equal to 1 and I less than or equal to n, I plus plus. And here we are going to write fact is equal to fact star I. Okay. So thank you, Seema. Thank you very much. So here, what I need to do, I need to return the factorial. So I'll explain this program for you. Don't worry if you're not getting. So factorial of a number is the product of the numbers from 1 to n. So now if you see here, I declared a variable fact equal to 1 and I declared a variable I. Now I have written a for loop for I is equal to 1, I less than or equal to n. N is the one which we are passing for this method. For example, if you pass the value 4, This for loop will iterate from 1 to 4. So every time which it iterates, we have initialized fact value to 1. So 1 into 1, that will be stored in fact, and I value becomes 2. Already fact value is 1, so 1 into 2, that will become 2, and fact value is 2 now. I value becomes 3, fact value is 2, 2 star 3, that will become 6. Fact value is 6. Now when I value becomes 4, already fact value is 6, so 6 star 4, that is 24. So 24 is returned to the place wherever we call this factorial. Now the use of creating this class is class and inside these two methods is, wherever you want to reuse this functionality, you can simply create the object for this class math library, and you can call those methods. For example, if I want to find factorial of number A, whatever I'm reading here, I can simply write here int result is equal to ml.factorial. I can write here yay. So this result will be populated with the factorial value that is calculated. So that is the advantage of using a class. So using a class, you can add any number of methods you want. You can add numbers, factorial, or any number of methods. And if you want to reuse them wherever you want, you can simply create an object of that, and you can actually do this. You can actually call those methods using object.methodName. Okay, so now the other definition of a class which we have is, a class is like a blueprint to create objects. So a class is the one which is having functionality. For example, let's remove this. So we'll have another method called, for example, I have a class called class student. Okay, and now here I have only one variable, public string student name. Okay, so now I have a class and I have only one variable, public string student name. Now, how to access this student name? I need to create an object for the student. So how to create an object? So I need to go to this program and here we need to create an object like this, student S1 is equal to new student. And actually I can assign the value for this variable, student name using object. So I can assign like this, S1 dot student name is equal to Raj. Or if I want to assign some other name, I want to store names of three students. If I want to store names of three students, I need to create three objects. If I don't create three objects, if I put S1 dot student name and if I try to assign another name called Meg, this will overwrite the previous value Raj. Okay, so if I want to store three students details, I want to create another object. So I need to write student S2 is equal to new student, and here I'm going to write S2 dot student name is equal to Meghnada. Okay, so we saw two types of classes. One class is math library, which is having methods, and the other class student, which is having only variables. So a class can have variables, a class can have methods, a class can have both variables and methods. Now if you see here, objects will be of different size. So for example, if you see the object S1, that's very small data we have. And if you see the object S2, we have little big data. So if you have a paragraph, like for example, if someone's name is too big, then they will have the data is very big. So now for example, let me open Windows or MS Paint. Okay, so now why do we call the class as a blueprint is, for example here, if you want to construct a house, you normally go to a civil engineer and he will give you the design. So that we call it as blueprint. So now in that, let's take that you have a house called like this. So let's assume that in that design document or blueprint you have a house like this. So let's assume that this is a small house. So using this design document, you can actually construct a very big house. This is a model. So this we call it as model or a blueprint or a design. So now you can actually create a small tie house with the same design. So maybe you can create a small tie house, or you can actually create a very big house, say for example like this. Okay, so that's what, so what I mean to say here is, objects can vary in their size. So objects, this is a class, and this is object 1, so this is like S1, and this is like S2. So object size can vary, but whereas class is like a blueprint to create objects, and this object S1 is an instance of this class. This object S2 is an again instance of this class. So I repeat again, a class is like a blueprint to create objects. So the structure of all the objects will be same like how you defined in the class. And what is an object? An object is an instance of a class. So if you see S1 is an instance of this class. It looks same functionality like how you have your class. And S2 is another instance of a class. So now if someone asks you to define a class, I'll define like this. The first definition which we saw is, a class is a collection of methods and variables. And the second definition which we are seeing now is, a class is a blueprint to create objects. A class is blueprint to create objects. Now, what is an object? An object is an instance of a class. For example, if you see here, this object S1 is an instance of this class, and which is having small data called Raj. And this object S2 is again instance of the student, and this is having bit lengthy data. So now, can someone tell me the two definitions of a class? Who wants to tell me the two definitions of a class? Can one of you can unmute and tell me the two definitions which we discussed now for a class? Yeah, so Sanjay, you can unmute yourself and you can tell for all of us. I'll tell once, maybe you can explain later. So I'm repeating again. A class is like a blueprint to create objects. To create objects. And the second definition, a class is collection of methods and variables. And what is an object? An object is an instance of a class. So anyone else wants to explain these definitions? Who wants to tell? Okay, Bhavik, go ahead, Bhavik. You can unmute and explain this to others. Okay, first,
hello, can you hear me?
Yeah. First, go ahead with the two definitions for class.
So, a class is a blueprint to create an object.
Perfect.
And the other one is a class is a class is a.
Yeah. So, what is that?
A collection of methods and variables.
Perfect. Yeah. Now, what is an object?
An object is an instance of a class.
Yeah. So, perfect. Thank you, Bhavik. Thank you. So, perfectly right. So, if you see here, why we are telling like a class is designed to create objects or a class is a blueprint to create objects? Because whatever you see in the object, more or less all the objects will replicate the class. So, if you see here, this S1 is a small house, which is actually having same like how you have your class. So that's the reason the definition of a class is like a blueprint to create an object. Now, what is this object? This object is just one instance of this class, one real instance of this class. Okay. Now, so anyone has any doubts in this? Okay. So for those who missed the previous classes, like we'll share the recordings. We are done with few classes. So we'll talk. I mean, H2K team will talk to those who missed the classes. We'll try to figure out a way so that you can cope up from now. Okay. Okay. So now let's go ahead with this again. So now, anyone has any doubts in the definition of this class now? Class and object. So, okay. So now I'm seeing a question from Sanjay saying like, so can we tell object holds DT means? What do you mean by DT, Sanjay? Okay. Right. So now, see here. So a class, an object is value type or reference type. For example, if you see here, I'm creating an object, student S1 is equal to new student and student S2 is equal to new student. So I have created two objects for this class student. Okay. So now I'm assigning this value S1.studentName equal to Raj and S2.studentName equal to Meghnadar. So this object will hold the data. So this object S1 will hold the data and this object S2 will hold this data Meghnadar. Okay. So now, any questions here? So this object will actually hold this data, whatever we are assigning to this. Okay. So Sanjay, is that answered your question? Okay. So can you type your question again? Like, okay. So the question from Sanjay is, what is the data type of S1? Okay. So S1 is of type student. Student is a new type. It is not, see here. So we have first one, we have something called value types. So what are the two types of data types which we discussed? So we have discussed about value types. Value types, data types are int, float, double, decimal, like this we discussed. And we have reference type. Reference types are something like string or class. All these are reference types. Now, if someone asks you what is the data type for int age, if someone asks you what is the data type for this age, the data type is integer. The data type for this age is integer. Now, if someone asks you what is the data type for string name, anyway, it's very clear that the data type for this name is string. Now, if I'm creating student S1 is equal to new student, so in that case, you need to tell that the type of the student is, the type of this object S1 is student. Student itself is a new type which is called class student. So S1 can hold the data only those variables which are present in your class. Okay, I repeat again, let's try to create a new project and we'll try to understand better. So this is the key for object-oriented programming. So I'll give some lot of examples to discuss on this. So file, new project. I'm going to create another console application. And here, so I'm going to create a new class. So I'm going to create a new class. Let me create student, for example. Let me create student. Okay, and here I have a method. I have variables called public string name, and another one public string name, and another one called public string course, which course he joined. Now I have a method now, public string print name, and what I'll do inside this I'll print the name of the student. So I'll write console.WriteLine, I'll print the name. Okay, so this method will print the name. Now I'll create another method called public, so this I'll put here void. We put like if this method is not returning anything. So as of now, this method print name is not returning anything, so I made this as void. So let me add another variable, public void print course. Okay, so now let me write here console.WriteLine. I'm going to write here course. Okay, so now how many variables I have in this class student? I have two variables, one is name and course. And how many methods I have in this class student? I have two methods, print name and print course. So I have two methods. Now what I will do is I'll create an object for this student. So now I'll create an object, student S1 is equal to new student. Now what I need to do, S1 dot name is equal to Meghnad. So Meghnad is a new student who joined the course called ASP.NET. Okay, so now if I call this method print name, it will actually print the name which I am assigning here. If I call this print course, this will actually print the course which I am assigning here. So all I need to do is S1 dot print name and I need to do S1 dot print course. So now if I do console.readline, okay, so now if I execute this, you can see here Meghnad and ASP.NET is there. So I have here Meghnad which is printed because print name is printing Meghnad, and print course is actually printing the course. So now if someone asks you what is the data, I cannot simply put here S1 is equal to Meghnad. So I cannot put like this because S1 is not a string. Even I cannot put like this, S1 is equal to 20 or something. So you can only assign or you can only use the way this object is designed for. So this is an object, and using object you will try to access the variables and methods. So that is the only use of objects. So this object is used to access these variables, and this object is used to access these functions. Okay, is it making sense for all of you? So now Sanjay, is it clear? Okay, so how about others? Okay, So how many of you are not clear? Please feel free to ask. So we'll continue. We'll completely discuss this concept in the class, in today's class, because this forms a basis for you for the remaining part of the course. So why we should say object will be of class type? Okay. So this object S1 is of type student. This object S1 is of type student. Okay. So now this object name is of type string. Similarly, this variable is of type string. This variable is of type student. So one question from Bhavik. So if you don't call print name, still it will print Meghnad. If you don't call print name, and if you want to print my name, so in that case you can write here console.write line. You can write s1.name. Okay. So normally, so let me tell this way. So this class student is having two variables. One is name and course. And this is having two methods, print name and print course. So now, the purpose of creating classes, you want to make this complete student functionality to be enclosed in the class. That we call it as data hiding or data abstraction. We have some theory concepts which we'll see in some time. But before that, this class is fully meant for student. So if I want to print name of student, I need to call print name. I don't want to write the logic here like s1.name. Okay. So I want to reuse these methods for my functionality. And I want to assign this using. So now I'm seeing one more question. So can we declare a string name instead of public string name? Okay, now question here, instead of public string name, can we declare a string name? Okay, good question. So when I declare the string name, by default, if I don't specify any data type inside a class, that will become private variable. So a private variable can be accessed only within the class. I repeat again. A private variable string name can be accessed only within the class. So if I want to access this value, I cannot assign here. I'm trying to assign s1.name outside the class, because my class is only here. I'm trying to assign this value outside the class. So which I cannot do it if this is of type private. So by default, if you don't mention like private string or public string or anything, that is private. I repeat again, by default, a variable in a class is private. Just a second. Okay, so now, by default, if you don't assign anything, like if you don't put public, private or anything, any access modifier, by default, the data type or the variable in a class is private. And a private variable can be accessed only within the class. If you see here, I'm trying to access this name inside this class method called printName, which is actually present in the same class. But when I try to assign the value for name outside this class, somewhere in this class program, it is throwing error. So what is that here I'm getting? Student name is inaccessible due to its production level. So when I make this string, when I make this variable as a private, so we cannot access outside the class. For that reason, I made it as public. When I make this as public, that means you can access this value anywhere. Normally in C# or any programming, object-oriented programming language, variables will be private. Normally, we'll make class variables as private and class methods as public. Class variables as private and class methods as public. So what they will do is, now you can ask me a question. then if we make this as private, how we can read the values? So I repeat again. So normally the class variables will be private and class methods will be public. So now can someone tell me, if I make this private, can I access? So now if I make this as private, and I'm making this also as private, now I cannot assign these values here. So now I can no more print name and print. If I do print name and print, if I cannot assign this here, so then what is the use of print name and print course? What is S1.name? I don't have anything. S1.name, S1.course, I cannot access here. So if I do S1.name, I'm not seeing at all. See here, when I put dot, am I seeing that name here? I'm not seeing that name. I'm seeing only print name, print course, and anyway, these four you know already. These four which is there for objects. So I'm only seeing print course and print name. But the moment I make this as public, so let me make this name as public. The moment I make this as public, and when I put dot here, so let me put dot here, I can see that the name is coming here. See now, I'm seeing this name here because I made this as public, but I'm not seeing course here because course is private. So from this, what we can learn is, by default, if you don't mention anything for a class variable, that is private. And the second point, if you mention the variable as public, you can access it outside the class. If you mention that as private, you can only access it inside the class. Now, and in object-oriented programming concept, it is best practice to write all the class variables as private. So now, if I make this as private, so I got a question now. Let's see what is the question. So can we call object like keyword like where as keyword? Okay, so we'll see that in some time. So by the end of the class, I will answer the question. Now, question to all of you. If I make this as private, then how can I assign the values here? Anyone knows it? Yeah, Seema, you're right. So we need to assign using methods. So what I'll do is, I'll write one more method. So public void read data, read student details. Okay, now what I'll do here inside this, I'll write here console.writeline, enter student name. And here I'll write here name is equal to console dot read line. Okay, and I'll write here console dot write line, enter student course. And here I'll write here course is equal to console dot read line. Okay, now if someone asks you where you are trying to assign this name, is it inside the class or outside the class? Inside the student class or outside the student class? It is inside the student class. So, as I said before, a private variable, where you can access a private variable? You can access a private variable only within the class. You cannot access outside the class. Now I cannot put here s1.name. S1.name, I cannot write here like this. S1.name is equal to Meghnad. I cannot do it anymore. The reason I made this name as private variable. The moment I make this as private, I cannot access this outside the class. So in order to assign Meghnad here, in order to read the value Meghnad here, the only way which I have is I need to call the method. What is that method? S1.readStudentDetails. Now I can access this. See now, when I run this now, this read method, read student details method, is a public method. See here, is a public method. So this method will in turn call enter student name, enter student course. So now let me run this. So I am entering student name as Meghnad, and I am entering student course as ASP.
Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.